St. Mark's. If you haven't already, please stand. We're going to worship and celebrate doing life big, moving from one phase to the next. And we're going to do it through some song, through some prayer, and through some good scripture. Here we go. One. So this next song, when I think about the ways in which we present ourselves and the ways in which we go out into the world, it's always a really powerful question to think about what legacy we're going to leave. And so my wish for all the graduates that are being honored today is that they take some time and think about the legacy that they are leaving and that they put that on every day of their lives. Here we go. This is Live Like That.
Father, help us live like you. Sometimes I think, what will people say of me when I'm only just a memory? When I'm home where my soul belongs, was our love? No one else would show up. Was our Jesus to the least of us? Was my worship more than just a song? I wanna live like that. Can really change your heart. Do I live like your love is true? People pass, and even if they don't know my name, is there evidence that I've been changed? When they see me, do they see you?
Privilege of honoring our high school and college graduates. We celebrate them and we give thanks to God for them and send them on with blessings and encouragement. But learning is a lifelong journey, and we are constantly formed by God's word. We give witness to what we know and what we don't know, to what we've learned and what we haven't. And we ask God to prepare us. Please pray with me now. Clothe us as your chosen one, Holy God. Let the word of Christ dwell in us richly. Teach us and admonish us so that whatever we do, in word or deed, we do in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to you, God our Father. Amen.
Good morning. How are you this morning? Good. We are pleased to have you worship with us, both in person and live streaming online on Facebook and YouTube. But we do ask that you fill out the Connect card, which is attached to your bulletin, and drop it in the plate as the offering plate comes around, along with your offering. We also would like for you to make sure that you update your information by filling in the correct information on that Connect card as we're trying to update all our files. We would like, our celebration of graduates will continue directly after this service in Zumwalt Hall as we have a reception for our grads and have gifts to give to them. And now please stand and take this time to greet your neighbor and offer them the peace of Christ.
Good morning. Thank you. Good, good. Everybody's good. All right, as you find your seats, we're going to start our celebration of our graduates with a video. Am I right or am I doing the wrong thing? Am I out of sequence? Am I right?
Times we had, I hope you smile and know that through the good and through the bad, I was on your side when nobody could hold us down. We claimed the brightest star and we came so far and know they won't forget. Yeah. Whenever
we
I hope you smile and know that through the good and through the bad, I was on your side when nobody could hold us down. We claim the brightest star and we came so far and no, they won't forget. Whenever you remember times gone by, remember how we held our heads so high when all this world was there for us. We believe that we could touch the sky. Whenever you remember, I'll be there. Remember how we reached that dream together. Whenever you remember,
congratulations, graduates. I know some of these folks are in the service with us here today, and I'd like to see if those of you who are here, I'd like to see. Yeah, it's hard up here sometimes to see. Isn't it, Lawrence?
Yeah.
The lights are in my eyes. I'd like to see if the graduates who are here would come forward. Come up here and high school and college graduates, those of you who are here, and we want to pray for you. Who's here? Come on, Kat's here, and Noah's here, and who else is here? Come on up here. I'm going to introduce you special. Noah and Kat. Oh, look, how many of these do I need? Which one do you want me to use? That one, because it's on? Oh, yeah, I like it when I preach like that. Oh, and of course Lizzie's here. You were already up here, weren't you? All right, tell people who you are and where you're going after this. I mean, you know, not where you're going, but, you know, what your plans are.
Okay, I am Noah Spivey. So as the video said, I'm planning on going to New Mexico Tech or NMSU, most likely in New Mexico Tech for mechanical engineering.
All right.
Hello, I'm Lizzie Candaria. I just graduated with my bachelor's in music education with a concentration in vocal performance, and I'm traveling abroad to go to England and then teach elementary school.
Hey.
My name is Catania Grau. I help out with the sound in the back, and I graduated with a bachelor's in commercial music, and I plan to work as in sound engineering.
All right, thank you. All right, and I have another special friend. I invited Christian Mitchell to come up here with me too. He didn't graduate high school yet. He is one of our St. Mark's students, and he's graduating kindergarten this year. And next week, we're going to recognize all our St. Mark's graduates. We'll do a little video. We'll recognize the kindergarten and eighth grade graduates from St. Mark's. We'll recognize our St. Mark's students. But Christian couldn't be with us next Sunday, so we said, come up here, and we're going to pray for you today. Do you want to tell them what your future plans are? I asked him earlier this week and asked him if he's going to get a job or what, and he thought he'd just go to first grade. Good job, yeah. All right, so wait a minute, don't go away yet. So we want to pray for these folks, and here's how we do it. Some of you can come up here if you will, and all of you can just reach out a hand, just reach out like this. Those of you who friends or family who want to come up here, and that's one of the signs in the Christian church is we lay hands on folks. So come up here, I need some of you to come up here, and we're going to pray for these folks. I reach out. You, great teacher, guide us all as students of life lived in faith. We thank you for the gift of these graduates, their excitement, their awesome wonder, and their curiosity, their open speech, their encouraging words. We have been blessed by them, and we are thankful for them. It is you who are the light that has passed from generation to generation in this journey of life. It's you who walking with these graduates, and as we pray for them to be blessed in your name, continue to walk with these graduates. And we pray for them now, lifting our hands, laying hands on them. May God grant you spiritual wisdom and understanding so that you may be able to see things from a spiritual point of view, so that your lives may be worthy of God and pleasing to Him. May you bear fruit in all that you do and continue to grow in your understanding of who God is. And may God give you the strength you need to endure whatever comes with patience and even kindness, always giving thanks to God who through Jesus Christ has given you new life. Go with God. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Thank you for sharing this day with us. Cat. All right, so you know, the kids are always welcome to stay in our congregation. We actually like to hear them, but I know that some of them like to go off and to a class that Miss Bianca has, and so now's a good time for you to go if you want to do that. All right. And we're gonna pray. That blessing, by the way, came from the first chapter of Colossians. I thought it would be appropriate because of we're going to read from a different part of Colossians for the sermon. All right, we ready to pray? What's next? All right, we want to come to this time of prayer and remember our community, remember our church, remember those who've asked for prayer this week, remember those who are fighting fires. I drove up I-25 early this week, and two of the fires are actually creating enough smoke to lower the visibility on I-25. So pray for our world. Pray for the safety of others. Let's pray. Prevail upon us today, O God. As praying people who gather today because we know the power of gathering to worship you, may our prayers be heard. May our desires for your will be done and fulfilled. As people of faith who've taken steps of faith because we sensed you leading us, lead us still, O Lord, to take new steps that will carry us to paths of liberation and transformation. May our hearts be open to your grace. May the hearts of our families and friends, strangers, all gathered here and all gathered online, may we be receptive to your presence. We pray for the safety of those in harm's way. We pray for those who are suffering. We pray for those who are sick. We pray that you'll stay with us to make us different than we were before encountering you today. Prevail upon us today, O God. And hear us as we pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As these ushers come to take our offering today, I want to thank you, especially those of you who made it possible for these graduates to go to school. Thank you for your generosity, and thank you for preparing for others who are going to school. I know we made a deal with our kids that when they started college or before they started college, we told them that we don't believe in debt to begin with, but we especially don't believe in going into debt to get a bachelor's degree. So we told our kids we would make sure that they could go to college without debt. And we didn't make that same deal about graduate school, but our kids will be ending. Sarah's already graduated, and Jackson will graduate without any debt. Thank you that you are considering that too. I think education is a huge step in our path, in our life journey. So thank you for your generosity. Let me offer this prayer. Gracious God, you gave us gifts, even the gift of students, family members. We thank you and pray that you will make them generous and us generous. In your name, amen.
As I get set up, as we get here set up to play this next tune, I want to thank Pastor Doug. I think sometimes, for whatever reason, and in some churches and some spaces and places, education, it just takes kind of a backseat to serving God. But thank God here at St. Mark's, because of the school and because of all the support that's around here and Pastor Doug and so on and so forth, education is front and center. So if we can get a big round of applause from the congregation for St. Mark's and for what they do in the community to keep education important. It's so important to me. I come from a family of educators. And as we play this song, I couldn't think of a better day to do this song. This is Do Life Big. Here we go. One, two, three, four.
Be.
solo in here. Here we go.
Scripture this morning comes from the New Testament book of Colossians, chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. Therefore, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called as one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom, and with gratitude in your hearts, sing praises, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God for this word. I chose this one particularly because I wanted to talk to the graduates. The rest of you can listen in if you want. All right. I want to say a few things, maybe some explanation. And I thought this was a great passage for this and also for maybe some of the things that are going on in our church, too. It speaks to us, I think. I hope so. So let me ask you, how many of you checked the mirror before you came this morning? Yeah. Okay, good. Yeah. How many of you forgot to check? No. You forgot to check the mirror. Yeah. So when you check the mirror, what do you look at? Don't be too specific here. What are you checking? You know, generally, you checking your hair, yeah, and you, yeah. John, do you get that hair? That one hair? Yeah. right. Right. You check your clothes, right? You check your clothes. See if you got them on, right? See if you got them on, and right. Right? That's what you do. You looked at it. Some of you dress for style. Some of you dress for comfort. We all dress for something, right? We all dressed for something this morning. Makes sense? So clothes bring attitude. Clothes can be a big deal. Graduates, think back to that day. I don't know, maybe it was a special day at school, or it was, I don't know if they still do senior skip day in high school or not. Do they? No? Yeah. And you had on your swimsuit and your T-shirt, right? Had your cap on backwards. You remember that day? Remember the attitude that went with it? Right? And then there was that day that you had that suit and tie on, or that formal dress on, or those prom clothes on. You remember that kind of stuck-up, can't touch this attitude. We could see that attitude in the pictures, couldn't we? Some of those. Some of that attitude we could see in those first baby pictures, too. Yeah. How many of you like to get dressed up? How many of you like to wear something nice? Clothes bring attitude. So I want to talk a little bit this morning about the clothes we wear, and specifically I want to talk about some of the funny clothes we wear at graduation time and in the church, the clothes we wear in church. Now, it's been customary in every age, every country, to invest those holding certain positions of dignity or practicing certain avocations with some kind of uniform or badge to give them special clothes by which their rank and their duties are designated. You know this, soldiers wear special clothes, right? By which he or she is distinguished from the ordinary citizen. Police officers, the firefighters, they wear special garb, making them set apart for a definite work. This is done for a twofold purpose. One, so that others may show respect. A judge wears a special robe derived from an academic gown to signify education and knowledge. And knowledge specifically of the law. But also, the judge's role in the court is different from the other participants. The judge is the person who's called on to be objective and to apply the law to the proceedings. And then secondly, the other reason for wearing those clothes is so that the office holder may respect him or herself and be more conscious of the duties of the job, more attentive to them on account of the uniform. Now, this is especially true of religious garb, and you can see this. It's interesting, particularly in the 21st century, to see how church styles have changed. And you've seen this even on TV. Can you remember those services, early services, that came from what was then called the Crystal Cathedral? Right on TV. Compare that now to the TV that you see. I don't know what you watch, but in religious garb, it's true. Now, in mainline Christianity, the priest or the preacher wears special clothing to be distinguished from other persons, and so that he or she may always be reminded that we are taken from among the people to offer gifts and sacrifices for sin. That's a quote from the letter to the Hebrews, to be a mediator between God and the Almighty. How'd this happen? Well, in the days of the Roman Empire, Roman senators and magistrates wore special clothing to signify their office. They wore clean clothes. That was special. Yeah, they wore clean clothes. They wore embroidered clothing. They wore chains with medallions, and they wore decorated scarves. Romans also wore togas. Yeah, Romans wore togas. Right? I know that you associate the toga, you college graduates especially, you associate the toga with the Greeks and the parties at the fraternities and the sororities. But the toga is a Roman article of clothing. Hey, I just happened to bring one today. Already gotten mine tied up. The toga is basically just a big sheet, right? It's so when the Roman soldiers were trying to deciding what to do with Jesus' clothes, right? They didn't want to cut it. They cast lots because they didn't want to divide it. It's just, well, I don't know how it goes. Oh yeah, I remember. I remember those toga parties, right? I never been to a toga party, right? It's sort of something like that. There. A toga. Well, hopefully when you go to your party, you can do it a little better. I've always had a little trouble with these things. But there you go. That's the toga. We have lots of pictures and paintings of Roman senators, Roman officials, statues of Romans wearing togas. You know what the toga symbolizes? I mean, this symbolizes peacefulness. It symbolizes comfort, right? A toga is a sign of leisure. It's what a Roman would wear to lounge around the house or around the office, maybe. It isn't a battle uniform. You wouldn't wear this into battle, even if you got a rope to go around it. I never can do this. I always have to get somebody to help me, right? Even if you had rope, you still wouldn't wear it into battle. It's just too revealing. You know what I mean? it's not made for battle dress. This is the sign of comfort. So when Christianity became the religion of the state-owned religion, in the 4th century, it became customary to give newly baptized persons a toga, a tunic, right? A new article of clothing. Each new Christian who was baptized was given a new, clean, white, washed in the blood of the Lamb, pure tunic. One purpose of the tunic was to remind the wearers of the white robes that are given to everyone in the New Jerusalem. We read this in Revelation over the last couple of Sundays. But not everybody wore a clean white tunic every day, right? By the 5th century, the white tunic was the standard wear for the priests, those who served in the churches. Different cultures had different ways of dressing, and different climates demanded different kinds of clothes, and these thin white tunics, great for the Mediterranean climate, weren't so good in northern Europe as Christianity spread. So as the Christianity went further into colder climates, the styles changed. Let's fast forward to the Middle Ages. When King Edward III granted a charter to this new place of learning called Oxford University in 1214, the vast majority of the professors were clerics. They were clergy. And they wore their regular clothing, their colorfully embroidered floor-length robes, which were the official academic wear. They wore something which became eventually to look like this. The tradition remains somewhat. The reason Harry Potter was filmed at Oxford is because there are still people walking around there wearing clothes like this. I attended Oxford three different times, and the first time I was there 100 years ago, folks still wore their black robes. When the hoods, along with the robe, because of the colder climate, they wore scarves. So you could have a scarf, right, to keep you warm, to keep your neck warm, to keep the rain off your head. You could turn it around. See? This was before umbrellas, of course, right? Best of all, you could turn it around again, and it was a bag. This is how you collected alms for the church. Put them in the bag. So that's what you did. So they're made of silk during the warmer seasons. They're made of fur in the winter. Jump again in time to the Protestant Reformation of the 16th century. By the time folks like Martin Luther were wandering around, Martin Luther and John Calvin and Philip Melanchthon, when those folks ruled in their small realms, there was little separation between the academy, that is the university, and the churches, between the schools and the places where they preached. So it became ordinary to preach in something that looked like this, right? In fact, this is called the Geneva gown because of the connection to John Calvin and the place. It indicates some relation. Its function, of course, was to keep the old professor warm, in a cold place. And you can see that the hood served that function of providing some warmth, right? Now, John Wesley wore a gown much like this all the time. We have paintings of him preaching outdoors in clothes that looked like this, in his Geneva gown. But American circuit riding preachers, they didn't wear these preaching gowns much. It's kind of hard to set a horse in this thing, right? So they didn't wear these. I'll hold this for a minute. In the 19th century, when the American church became settled into buildings, think about that. In the 19th century, the church became settled into buildings. Where was it before it was in buildings? It was just on the corner. It was under a tree. It was in a lean-to, right? Those were the standard places. But then it became settled into buildings. Preachers began to wear the clothes that resembled the formal or the business wear of the country's wealthy class. From the 1920s to the mid-1940s, many Presbyterian ministers wore preaching suits for Sunday service. A preaching suit looked like something made of heavy wool. It was charcoal gray. It had cutaway or a swallowtail. They called it a morning coat. It's the kind of thing that you would wear if you were an attorney and you had to argue a case before the Supreme Court. You still do have to wear that. The style, perhaps pretentiously, certainly curiously, typified Fifth Avenue formal wear. It modeled the urban upper middle class. What were these preachers saying about themselves and about their churches? Right? It said that they belonged to the business set, that they were professionals. Certainly didn't indicate that they were set apart so much. So this Geneva gown, with the closed black robe, the Puritan were tab collars. If you saw me on the 1920s night that we had, the school wore tab collar. All right, this robe began to replace that Fifth Avenue suit around 1945. That's not so long ago, right? Many Protestant ministers came to wear this Geneva gown in worship, although its liturgical purpose seems a little suspect to me. The style had been imported to the university from the churches. In colonial America, King's College, which is now Columbia University, was among the first to use academic costumes in a graduation service. In 1887, an American firm began to manufacture these costumes called Gardner Cottrell Leonard. He was a graduate of Williams College. He designed and produced these costumes. He subsequently researched heraldry and costumes of Europe, and he founded that company, which became known and still is as Cottrell and Leonard, a firm that's manufactured these gowns that all our graduates wear. And he created this particular commission, a code to regulate the design of these things. So the modern undergraduate cotton gown has pointed sleeves, right? At some schools, the lining of the hood has different colors to designate the degree or the school itself. What colors a theology student would wear scarlet to indicate the red blood of the martyrs. It just so happens that a PhD in history from Texas Tech would also wear scarlet and have velvet panels on the robe. Right, yes, the Raiders, that's right. And hash marks or crossbars on the sleeves. I, for one, don't like to wear this in church. I know a lot of ministers who do. I know a lot of ministers who will even wear their hood in church because they have divinity degrees. But the school isn't part of the church. There's too much separation. I much prefer to wear what? I prefer to wear that white, right? That white, new white garment that was given to me at baptism. Not this particular one, but one like it, right? That's what this is, my new white garment. That's why we put our acolytes in those white things in the 11 o'clock service. I also like to wear a stole. Two reasons for the stole. One, the stole signifies the mantle scarf that the prophet Elijah passed on to the prophet Elisha. It also symbolizes the yoke that the prophet Jeremiah talked about. A yoke is not a part of an egg. It's the thing that ties a horse to a chariot or ties the donkey to the cart. Right? It's only worn by ordained persons to symbolize the tie between me and the church. I'm yoked to the church. People say to me, I don't have the right clothes to wear in church. I say, baloney. We all have the right clothes. You have to wear the clothes that fit. Don't wear the clothes that fit somebody else. Right? You can't wear somebody else's clothes. Nobody wants to see James wearing one of Kristen's outfits, right? You got to wear the clothes that fit you. Right? Wear the clothes that fit you. I like ties, so I wear ties. Maybe you like jeans. Maybe you like shorts. Maybe you like t-shirts. I'm telling you, you can wear anything you want to church. Our only rule is that you have to wear some clothes. To your own self be true, Shakespeare said. Wear whatever you like, because God is going to provide you with other clothes. So that's the lesson from Colossians. God has clothed us with some attitudes, with the right clothing. Get the right clothes on. When you get the right clothes on, you get the right actions in gear. But you've got to be clothed first. So let's look again at what Colossians says. Therefore, as God's chosen people... Don't you just love knowing that you're one of God's chosen people? You should wake up every morning and look in the mirror and say to yourself, I am chosen, right? God's chosen people. Clothe yourself, what? Clothe yourself with compassion. You know what compassion is? I'll give you a definition. Compassion is love that acts. Right? When it sees hungry people, guess what it does? In United Methodism, it forms a committee, a study group, and it talks and it figures out why they're hungry and why they're homeless. No, that's not compassion, right? That's what the church does. Compassion feeds the hungry. Look here. Wear kindness, Paul says to the Colossians. Wear kindness. Aren't you glad to know that we need a little kindness again? I think we just need to be kind again. How many of you, when you're out there shopping at Walmart, right? When you're standing in line there, you remember, oh, I'm wearing kindness today. When you're driving your car, this is a big one for me. This is my temptation, right? Driving your car, I'm wearing kindness today. Put on kindness. Now look, these are not undergarments. These are not the clothes you leave on the floor for your mom to pick up when she does the laundry, right? These are the clothes that we all see. These are the things that you want to keep clean because we're looking at it. Compassion, kindness. Are you wearing kindness when you have your WWJD bracelet on, right? Or your St. Mark's t-shirt? Holy cow. Nothing scarier than that, right? Need something else to wear? How about some humility? along with some gentleness. Add in some patience. Wear these things. And when you wear these things, it means people are going to see them. People are going to look at them. They're going to see what you are by your clothes. They're going to see your attitudes. We see the clothes you wear. Do we see kindness? Do we see compassion? Humility? Gentleness? Do we see patience? Rarely, right? Because these are the clothes that God gives us. Passion and kindness. Well, graduates, maybe you'll get to wear that graduation again sometime, the graduation gown again sometime. I don't know. Maybe you'll get to wear one of those with doctor's stripes, wear one of those long hoods. I looked for my hat today. I couldn't find my, you know, my cap. I don't know if you get to wear those again, but you always get to wear compassion and kindness, humility, gentleness, patience. You always get to put them on with love, love that binds us together. Sounds like a song. We'll sing that one of these days. To graduates, as your church, as your family, we simply ask that you wear these things well. Okay. Lawrence, band, come up here and lead us in a song.
Thank you, Pastor Mills, for that beautiful word. We have one more song for you this morning. It's one we do a lot. And I found myself this service finding songs that we do a lot, but for some reason today, the songs that I picked seem to just mean all that much more. So we hope you enjoy this. This is Everywhere That I Go, Israel Houghton.
So lonely.
Everywhere that I go.
you'll never leave. I'm never forsaken. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Well, for me, surrounding me where I go.
Just lift your hands and worship God. If he's surrounded you, if he's been your shield, if he's been your rock, if he's been your foundation, just lift your hands and take a second to adore him, adore the things that he's done in your life. Here we go. We're going to sing these words, church.
You are the shield around me everywhere, everywhere that I go. You are the shield around me everywhere, everywhere that I go. You are the shield around me everywhere.
Your grace.
Your grace and love surrounds me everywhere. Never forsaken. Whoa, whoa, goodness and mercy will follow me, surrounding me where I go, everywhere that I go.
Go forth clothed with righteousness, the clothing that God gives you. Go forth to love and serve God and your neighbor in all that you do. With the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Remind you that we're having a reception for the graduates in Zumwalt Hall. You're invited to walk over there down the hall and join in.
Come on.